Hi everyone, today we are going to introduce a content algorithm called Content Support Vector Machine. We will start with Classical Support Vector Machine and evolve from there. Despite its fancy name, SVM is an algorithm to teach computers to solve classification problems. Like, what's the number on the picture? Is a receiving email a spam? Or is a patient sick based on his medical record? Here, let's look at a simple case. We want to teach computer to separate blue squares from the red ones. To do that, we need to draw a hyperplane to separate them. Though many hyperplanes can be drawn, we want to pick the one with maximum margin. Here are the equations to calculate the optimal hyperplane. This part is what we want to minimize, known as cross-function. It will give us weights for features. Now we are in the perfect world. Well, not exactly. What if the dataset looks like this? It can't be separated linearly. But we can still handle it. If we calculate the distance from each point into the center, we create a new feature which helps us to separate the dataset perfectly. The function to create new features from the original ones is called kernel. With kernel, we are mapping an old feature space to a new one. M can be smaller, equal, or greater than N depending on the kernel function. Here is a step-by-step way to do the SVM. Prepare a classified dataset as our training set. Map features to same scale, like from -1 to 1. Get new features space by using a kernel. Optimize weights by minimizing cost function, test model. Here are equations for your reference. Now we are in the proper world again.
What if we hack the kernel such that it is easy to compute on a quantum computer, but hard for a classical computer? The result is a quantum support vector machine, or QSVM. The steps for the first QSVM method in this paper are similar to the steps involved in the SVM. However, the authors use a specially designed training set, map the features onto qubits, and use a quantum computer to evaluate the kernel. First, the authors generate a training set designed to be easy for the QSVM to handle. The exact process for generating this data is shown here. This mapping depends on the states 5 above, but how do we generate the states? It turns out these states are generated by mapping the data from each point onto two qubits, one qubit for each feature. The exact mapping is performed using this unitary gate. Note that the last line describes a nonlinear mapping from the original data entries into a new space. This brings us to this quantum circuit. The unitary described in the last slide was chosen specifically so that it is difficult for a classical computer to simulate. This unitary is also used to generate fake data, which is easy for the quantum computer, but hard for the classical computer. This is the basis of the quantum speedup in this paper. Next, the kernel is calculated by choosing one point for x and iterating through all the points as z in this circuit. Intuitively, it encodes the data using ux and then attempts to reverse the operation by applying uz dagger. Note that if x equals z, then ux equals uz, and the result of the circuit is the all zero state. If x is close to z, then ux is close to uz, and the result of the circuit has a large amplitude in the all zero state. This amplitude is essentially a distance between states x and z and estimates the kernel. Then, like the classical SVM, we optimize the weights to minimize the loss function.
The second approach is to use what is called a quantum variational eigensolver, or VQE for short. The procedures here are similar to the classical and inner product approximation approaches. Except in this case, we will not calculate kernel, and the optimization is done with a quantum computer. We will use the same generated dataset. Map feature vector x on the block sphere. But then in the third step, we apply what is called a nonsense. Basically, it allows us to perform weighted rotation L times on the block sphere. Since feature vectors are already encoded at some non-linear angles, these answers provide higher descriptions and enables us to search optimal weight data. We then measure the output of the ansatz according to this measurement operator in the z-axis that changes for different test labels. We will obtain a distribution of 0 and 1s, which will be mapped to plus 1 and minus 1 accordingly. We assign a label plus 1 if the probability of measuring zeros are larger than 1s and vice versa. The bias term is to account for the situations where probability of measuring 1 is larger than measuring zeros, when in fact the majority of such labels belong to the label plus 1. We define the error or the residual function as the average error of a training set whenever measurement is not agreeing with the predetermined label. Notice the function of distribution p you obtain by measuring the ansatz and the bias parameter b. Lastly, this is to be ran on the optimizer recursively. The error function will be minimized, giving us an optimal theta and bias b to classify datasets. The gradient descent is done on the block sphere instead of the linear search as in the classical approach.
We implemented the first QSVM method in Qiskit alongside an SVM on the same dataset. As you can see, the QSVM is more accurate. This is unsurprising given the way the data were generated. There are several limitations to current QSVMs. First, the number of qubits required scales linearly with the number of features. Second, it requires a special data set to obtain a speedup over a classical compute. Finally, it turns out QSVMs are only faster than SVMs for problems which are polynomial time for classical computers.